New Orleans. Walking through the graveyards, just like an easy rider, on my way to a story for Cherry Magazine and the girls of the Big Easy. The geniuses at Cherry had given me my first credit card and saddled me with a short, dyspeptic Chinese photographer called Wally Wang. This was my first assignment, and man, I was really getting into it. Wally, I said, this is fucking great. First thing we're gonna do is score some weed and maybe some coke and get some Dixie beer and start cousin oysters. And then we're going to the strip club to meet the girls. But Wally was having none of it. To you, he sputtered, this is New Orleans. To me, this is Louisiana and they hate my chink ass. We're taking pictures and we're leaving. 2 days later, Wally and I were still going strong with a couple of Bourbon Street strippers, both named Bunny. Now, the Super Bowl was going to be in New Orleans that year, and our idea was, after we did a series of nature photographs, and every top was joined the corner, to throw a criminally sexy Super Bowl soiree in a hotel room, and then build a theme issue around our little fiesta. Now, these bunnies were very sexy, but they were never going to make it to the Playboy Centerfold. I'm not even sure their real names were Bunny. But they liked to have fun. We were the Big Time Magazine guys from New York City, and they were the topless dancers in the French Quarter, and everybody was happy. We took good care of them. They were stars. They were going to be in a magazine. No trifling feat for a couple of girls from Jefferson Parish. The fact that we all got along so well was what my boss would have called a perquisite, had he known the word. Now, the hotel room was about as low rent as you could get. Everything was bolted down, including the Gideon Bible. In terms of production values, this wasn't Star Wars. It wasn't even Deep Throat. It was more like the Zapruder film. We bought a case of cheap champagne and filled the bathtub with ice, and the girls dropped some ecstasy. They may not have had the makings of Gone with the Wind, but had all the elements of a pleasant afternoon. Never underestimate the dramatic impact of a couple of teacup strippers getting it on in football helmets and heels. Now, let me set the mise-en-scene for y'all. We filled the frame with flesh. Tits. And beers. And various toy footballs. Filling various orifices, and girls soaked in this cheap champagne, tongue-bathing each other. And colored streamers. I know, it sounds pretty stupid, but it was supposed to be a party, right? And I thought it would add some color, and in the end, it did look pretty good. But this is what's going on. As the girls are fooling around, and the champagne's getting spilled everywhere, the streamers start bleeding ink on the sheets. Now, the red made it look like a pig had just been slaughtered, but the blue was just plain fucking weird. There was no way to explain it, except maybe a Smurf got whacked in there along with the pig. It was all very unsettling. When the maid came in the next morning, she looked like she was going to call the X-Files. Now, up until that point, it was probably the greatest weekend of my life. I had been taken to score some weed in a stolen Z-car by a hooker with a heart of gold. And I was taken to a rodeo-themed gay bar by an ambitious young exotic dancer. It was the last open bar in the quarter, and we wanted to carry on, you see. We were still thirsty. And then she punched out a guy wearing leather chaps who tried to grab my ass because she thought I might be upset about a guy in leather chaps grabbing my ass. And she took me back to my hotel room and took good care of me. A real rock and roll nurse. But perhaps my favorite moment of the weekend was when I got a blowjob from another somewhat more provincial stripper who took me into a back room and she said,